Welcome back. This is Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we're having great fun speaking with Lisette Oropesa. Let's look at a completely different area of your life, and that is running.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's a big part of your life.
It is.
Why? How did you start running, and why did you start running one day?
I started running as part of a very long journey that I began many years ago. When I first came to the Met, I was quite heavy. I was obese, actually. And part of my work there as a young artist was in trying to get my body to the healthiest that it could possibly be. And my weight was really a problem because I didn't have a lot of mobility on stage, and I really felt like it was hindering me in a lot of ways. And also, as a young lyric coloratura, the voice parts that I would play that would suit me vocally tended to be cast in a different physical body than what I had. So I realized, and I got the advice from my mentors in the Young Artist Program, that I was going to need to really get my weight in check. So I started going to the gym, and this is from someone who never exercised and ate everything. I started going to the gym over the summer, and I kind of and I lost 20 pounds. And I came back to the Met the second season of my as being a young artist, and they were so proud of me. And I had kind of started this new regimen of going to the gym 5 days a week. So I was going to the gym 5 days a week, and I started losing weight. And I started noticing that my body was changing. I was feeling better. I was feeling more in control. I felt more confident. My clothes were fitting great. But I never ran. Running was something I avoided like the plague for many, many years. Because when I was a kid, I had a horrible running, like, memory.
When you were losing weight,
I was losing
did you
weight.
Worry about, you know, as far as singing goes?
I didn't, because I was doing it the right way. And it took me many, many years to lose a substantial amount of weight. So I didn't go on a crash diet. I didn't start taking any pills. I didn't starve myself. I was, I only exercised, but I didn't change my diet. And then I started gradually over years changing my diet until 5 years. It took me 5 years to lose 80 pounds.
Wow.
Before I even started running. So I got down to basically the weight more or less within 10 pounds that I am now. And I started traveling a lot. And I realized that I wasn't going to always be able to just go to the local gym, because you can't always just go and get a one-month subscription to the local gym. And so my husband and I kind of had a chat, and we said, well, we're going to travel together. You know, we need to find something exercise-wise that we can keep doing, because we need to maintain, you know, you have to maintain your fitness. You have to keep exercising. And I certainly didn't want to. I had come such a long way, and I didn't want to go backwards. And so I said, well, I suck at running. How about you? He said, yeah, I suck at running too. I said, okay, great, let's do that. So we both decided to start running on the hottest day of the year. It was like August 20-something. And we went outside in Riverside Park here in New York. Okay, let's see how far you can go without stopping. Okay, let's see how. Okay, so we start going out there, and it's like, it was a mess. And I don't think we went 1 mile before we were both like, okay, this is what we're going to learn to do better. And so we started just kind of building it from zero. And it was the kind of thing we were doing not every day, but every other day, you know, because we'd be sore. And then we kept trying to go a little farther, till eventually we ran like 2 miles. I remember when it was like the first time we ever run 2 miles. And then it was the first time we'd ever run 3 miles. And it kind of just built from there. And so I fell in love with it. Running took over me like flu. It was the most amazing bug to catch, because I was like, this is great. You could be outside, see people, away from any kind of electronics or distractions or screens, and you just be in nature and inhale fresh air or whatever. And it was something, especially here in New York, you know, it's a really, really great running culture here. So we started doing that, and then we started traveling, and we started running in every city we would go to. And it was a great way to learn the city, because you get to see the park, and you get to kind of know the geography, and you knew how far a mile was in every direction from your house. And so we built from there, and then I kind of fell in love with distance training, and we did our first half marathon a couple of years after we started running. And then I was like, oh, let's do a full marathon. Okay, well, let's do a full. Actually, somebody that met was Kathleen Belcher, was the first person to ever encourage me to do a full marathon. I said, I don't know, Kathleen. Everybody's telling me I should try for a marathon. And she said, you can do it. I said, okay. And I'll never forget that. That's like my mantra now. You can do it. She just looked at me and said, you can do it. And that was it. And I was like, okay, you know what? And that running has taught me, this is why I think I'll never quit. Running has taught me more about myself and who I am as a human being, as a physical being, than almost in some ways than singing. Because when you're singing, at least when I sing, singing is natural for me. I have been singing since I was 3. I have been hearing singing and it just comes out of my mouth. It's always what I've always done. Running is not natural for me. Running is something I am terrible at. I am not a gifted, natural athlete. In PE and in school, I was always the last person to be picked. I was always the last person to finish the mile in our little track that we had to do. I hated it. Everything about it was completely the opposite of who I am. So because now running is such a part of me, and it's something that I've devoted many years to, you know, basically by stubbornness, just sheer will and determination and devotion, I am so much more proud in a lot of ways of the things I've been able to get to. Like, I never thought my body could run a marathon. I never even thought my body could run 2 miles. It was like, and every victory, every time I achieve something new, I go a little faster or I run up a hill or back down. It means so much to me because this is not what I do. I am not an athlete. And so it's kind of the miracle of the human body. You know, when you really put your mind to something and you really work at it, your body, you know, will get there if you really work on it and you devote the time. And
there's one moment that you kind of say, okay, I never exercised before and
yes,
everything.
I never exercised before.
Where is that coming from? Say, well, I am going to do it.
I don't know. I have
it
this,
must be something.
I have this accomplishment bug. I don't know what it is. In fact, I'm kind of an overachiever. I've always been a little bit of an overachiever ever since I was young. My sister told me it's my biggest flaw. I'm never satisfied. If I've accomplished, like, I speak 2 languages. No, it's not enough to speak 2. I have to speak 3. No, 3's not enough. I have to speak 4. I have to speak 5. In fact, I have to speak it really well. In fact, I need to be conversational in every single. In fact, I need to not just, you know, do this well, but I need to do it. I need to be excellent. I need to excel in everything that I do. And I have this kind of bug, I don't know, that I feel like I want to do everything as well as I possibly can do it. And because I can't run, or I couldn't run, it was like, you know what, that's the thing I'm going to go after, because that's what I'm the worst at. And so I just feel like it's just how I am. And it's a little bit of a double-edged sword, because on the one hand, you're always trying to better yourself at everything that you do. But on the other hand, you're never really satisfied with any of your accomplishments. And people will go look at you and say, oh, but you play the instrument, and you do this, and you've sung this, and you've done that, and you've done this, and you speak these languages, and blah, 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 and you run marathons, and you're vegan now, oh my God, and you're plant-based, and isn't that enough? You've lost all this weight. Isn't it enough? You know, and I'm always like, you know what? I could do better. I could be a nicer person. I could be more forgiving. There's some personal flaws I'd like to work out.
Does that make you happy?
What, being better? Working on something? Yes. I need a reason to get up in the morning. You know, I feel like, and when I go to bed at night and I think about, you know, the world, I always lay in bed and I sit there and my husband and I, and we talk about society and the universe and all the big ideas and why are things this way and what can we do differently? What can we do better? You know, how can I help? How can I set an example? Maybe that's what I should do. I should set an example. I should try to be the person that I would want to meet on the street and talk to. You know, I want to be a better friend or a better musician or a better artist or a better colleague, you know. And so I always feel like if there's any, and of course, I'm not saying this means that I ever achieve those goals on a daily basis. No, it's like every morning I wake up and, okay, today I fresh slate. I'm a positive person. I'm a naturally very sunny kind of optimistic person, and I want to be that every day. And on days when I wake up and I don't feel like that, you know, there's usually a big reason why. I don't wake up and hate my life. I wake up and love my life, and then I'm just like, I just want to go and grab it by the horns and just make the most of it. What can I do today?
Do you ever have a down moment?
Oh yeah, I think that's one of the things actually about being an artist is that you get very much in touch with your range of emotions. And because I've always been a musical person and an expressive person, and growing up as a Latin person in a Latin house, you know, we weren't taught to suppress ourselves. We were all girls. And I feel very fortunate in that aspect because I was the oldest. So I was the responsible one, the one that everything had to kind of, I was the one that had to be the kind of the pride of the family. I still feel like that, actually. And so having that need to always kind of be on was something that I feel like that's just who I am. So if and when I have a down moment, and I can have them because we know our emotional range is like huge. And in fact, the more you study music, the more you sing, the more you use your actual voice to express emotion, you start really finding deeper layers, deeper things that are hurting inside. Or and especially when you become as you become a better actor, as you experience more theater, and you work with different directors, and they bring out little things in you, you know, that maybe you don't like to bring out, but they're like, "But this is great. This is what the character needs. This is the character's flaw." And maybe it's a flaw you might actually have. And so your fears and all that. I mean, I have tons of that. And I feel like, but I'm not afraid of it because I know that weaknesses and flaws and ugliness or whatever you want to call them, negative traits that, yes, I might have in me and I don't want to have them forever. I'd love to not have any traits like that, you know, the things that hurt me. I also know in a lot of ways that they serve me as an artist. Because if you've suffered, if you've experienced pain, if you've experienced loss, if you've experienced heartbreak, whatever, those things, you need to be able to get to those emotions because you do really need them in opera. And so I feel a lot of times that it helps, especially with a really great director who can tell when I'm being authentic and tell when I'm not. And they'll say, "No, that's not authentic. You know, you're fake crying in this moment, or you're fake, I know you're phoning it in." And I don't want to be that person that phones it in, but it's to not phone it in is quite scary because you have to be very vulnerable on stage. You're already vulnerable because you're singing, and there's no instrument between you and what the audience, you know, you're not playing an external instrument. It's you, audience, and through the music, you know. And that's very much like, oh God, it's me. It's my actual physical being, my physical self. And so there's already that vulnerability. Then there's, oh, and the character is suffering, or oh, the character is dying, or the character has this problem with her father, or whatever the character is. And so it just makes it very open, extremely open, which is vulnerable. And that's a really scary place to be.
Now, talking about running is a big part of your life.
Yeah.
How do you relate to music? Could be helpful. Right.
Yeah. Well, I mean, as singers, you know, because our body is our instrument, you know, we're paid to sing. And in order to sing, you really do have to be in the best health possible. Because, I mean, when you get sick, in fact, I'm just getting over a cold. When you get sick, the first thing that goes is your voice. And it's the kind of thing that, yeah, you can't just phone it in and, you know, type the keys and your job will be done. It's not like that. You have to be physically very, very energized. And because it's a job nowadays, especially, that requires more and more physicality on stage, you know, we're breaking the boundaries of kind of traditional operatic staging that I think a lot of people have a stereotype in their mind of what opera is, and people stand there and they sing. It hasn't been like that for many, many years, I would say. And now, you know, because you have to be active, you have to be, especially the characters that I often play, which are young characters, full of energy and passion and putting everything out there. And those are the kinds of characters that, you know, I find myself out of breath. Even as an in-shape person, I find myself out of breath trying to sing and do what the physical, you know, demands of the role are. So yes, in that aspect, running has helped me tremendously because it's made me feel like my heart rate is lower all the time. I don't sweat as much on stage, for example. And I also just feel more just in command of my body. I'm aware of where my body is in space. You know, I'm aware of the little things that, you know, I can find positions that are more comfortable. I'm more strong. I'm more centered. My balance is better. I mean, I sleep better. All those things, I really feel like it's because I have, I exercise regularly. And I maintain a very strict diet. And it's just plant-based. And I've done that about as long as I've been running. So that's been a part of my life. I did that for health reasons. And it's also made a huge difference because I don't have reflux anymore. I used to have terrible reflux. I don't have reflux. I almost never get stomach aches. I am a very regular I have a very regular schedule. I'm much more, I know a lot more about nutrition now, a lot more about food. I understand what I'm putting in my body. I cook now almost every night. In fact, my husband and I almost never go out to eat because now that I, the more you learn, the more you go into like the health black hole, the more you learn about, you know, what's in your food, where it comes from, you know, what's in it nutritionally, how many calories does this have, you know, exactly how does this affect your body, where are the real proteins, all that stuff.
Where do you feel, let's talk about your career, where do you feel you're going as far as, say, roles you're singing? Are you singing, I hate to use the word heavier, but more lyrical roles away from the Susannas? Is that happening as you planned, or do you plan it at all?
It's the kind of thing so far, Dennis, that my voice has changed somewhat from when I first started, and so I actually don't have another Susanna on my calendar for the foreseeable future. That kind of happened by accident. It wasn't because I said, oh, I don't want to sing Susanna anymore. It just kind of happened. In Europe, I sing roles that are probably considered heavier than the ones I sing in America. So like Gilda, I've just sung Lucia. I would eventually start to sing Traviata there. I sing Constanza in Europe. I've sung them in America too, but I feel like in Europe, because the houses are smaller, my voice type, which is a lighter lyric coloratura, doesn't pose a problem for roles that are maybe more bel canto, that tend to be associated sometimes with much more full lyric voices. Like at the Met, you know, you have to consider how big the Met is. The Met can't cast necessarily a light voice in the same way that, say, Vienna can in a role that with the Met Orchestra and the size of the Met, it won't cut. And so I feel like a lot of times people get the idea that, you know, a Met-sized voice is one thing, and then a European-sized voice is another. So a lot of my work in Europe has been in roles that are much more, I guess, more full.
Is Traviata in the books?
Traviata is, I've sung it already once in Philadelphia, mm-hmm. and I do have Traviatas coming up in 2 years. Mm-hmm. So it's not something I'm rushing into, and it's not something I'm, like, throwing myself into, but, like, actually, a year from now. That would be 1 year. A year from now, I've got a Traviata planned.
We have a bit of a harbinger of your Traviata because we have a clip from a...
Oh, really?
I think it's an AIDS benefit where you sang, of course, the aria.
Yes.
Let's hear, I think it's the end of it.
It's the cabaletta, yeah. Oh, thanks.
The entire role is certainly something to look forward to.
Thank you.
For you and for audiences in the future.
Thanks.
So is that the limit, or will you go beyond Violetta?
Not at the moment. I mean, I feel like I really cannot predict the future, honestly. I think Traviata is the heaviest thing that I have coming up. Because honestly, there are other bel canto roles I haven't sung yet that I want to do before I start rushing into heavier things. I'm not in a hurry to sing Mimi or anything like that. In fact, I don't even know that that's ever going to happen for me. I'm very aware of what my voice wants to do, and I would love to sing more Bellini, more Donizetti, even some Rossini roles. You know, I'd love to sing Puritani. I've never even had the opportunity. I want to sing more Lucia. I've only sung Lucia really 3 times, now 4. And the first time I just sang it in a big house was at the Royal Opera House just last month. And I would love to sing Lucia more. I feel like there's more to explore in that role that I haven't gotten to do yet. And I feel like as long as my voice serves me to sing that repertoire, I'd rather sing that repertoire longer than push it into repertoire that's, you know, that requires a fuller lyric sound, particularly because I don't, I mean, my voice has the agility and the extension and things like that that serve lyric coloratura parts better at the moment.
You seem very confident in what you are doing. In the moment when you're walking on that stage, do you have fears?
Oh, yeah.
What kind of fears?
Oh, God, that I'm going to black out and forget everything that I've ever meant. My biggest fear is that I'll wake up one morning and my voice won't work. That my voice, I'll be mute.
Nightmares about this.
Oh, all the time. My husband even has them. It's awful. I have the stage fright nightmare. I have the pushing, you're being pushed on to sing a role you don't know. And you're being pushed on and you're like, wait, I need to see the score. And what am I? But in real life, in reality, going on stage, yes, I'm always, especially God, when it's a debut or a role, a new role that I haven't done before, or a new house that I know has a very discerning audience, like I felt when I went on stage as Lucia in Royal Opera House. My heart was like this. We had rehearsed and rehearsed, and I knew what I was doing, and I felt so confident, and I sung the role a lot, and I felt like, oh, this is going to be a shoo-in for me. I feel so confident in what I'm doing. And I'm on stage during that harp solo, getting ready to go on before Lucia, and my heart was like, and I was like, Lisette, girl, you need to get this heart rate down, child, because this is not going to work. And so I'm just like, and I have like... And I actually, she has this like entrance, she goes on stage and she has this encounter with the ghost, at least in the production we did in Covent Garden. She has this encounter with the ghost. And the girl who played the ghost looked into my eyes and it was just like, I had this like wash of, it's gonna be okay. And I was like, oh my God, this is the beautiful thing about colleagues on stage with you. A colleague knows what you're feeling. They can feel the energy come off of you like it's like as though you had slapped it on top of them. And so if their energy is, it's gonna be all right, I know you're gonna be fine. Or if they're afraid, you feel that and you come back for them and you reach your, whatever, that is something that is a language that is so sacred to singers and performers on stage together. And when I started singing, the other colleague that I had, the lady who plays Alisa, she was on stage with me the whole time. And she turns up stage and I'm singing to her and she just went. Because she knew. I mean, it didn't even have to communicate. I mean, it was just like we knew. And I was just like, thank you so much for that. That made me feel so much better because you feel kind of alone. The audience is like there.
Sure.
You know that they're there, but you feel like, oh God, they're looking this time, like this is real, this is real this time. They might not applaud, they might not, they might boo, you know? So you never know what the audience is gonna take away from your performance. And I feel like, and you never know what you're gonna have available to put out. You know, you practice all you want, but you know, every day is a new set of whatever, environmental challenges, you know? Maybe there was some dust in the air, maybe you cried about something earlier and your throat's all choked up, or maybe you ate something you shouldn't have and you're kind of feeling a little gassy or whatever. It could be 100 different things that make you, you know, you're not always 100% exactly the same. And you're never 100%, you know. Scott told me, nobody's ever 100%. You have to learn how to sing as well as you can at 75 or 50, you know. You have to, that's the training and the experience, you know. And so I just feel, I always just do my best. Given the circumstances, I always do the best that I possibly can, whatever that is.
I think you're doing very well.
Thanks.
On that note.
Yes, keep doing what you're doing. On that note, we have to stop it. Thank you, Lisette, so much.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here with us.
Thank you for having me. Thank you both.
This has been Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we've had the great pleasure of speaking with Lisette Oropesa.